our work relates to infants and, in fact, perinatal health and perinatal epidemiology all the way through the aging process. We have particular areas of focus and strength in women's and perinatal health, in early child health and development. We do quite a fair amount of work in adolescent development, and within that, some very exciting work in reproductive health, both male adolescent and young adult male reproductive health, as well as issues of teen pregnancy and sexually transmitted diseases, going through aging and issues of frailty in aging populations. So it truly is a lifespan. We have a team of faculty who are looking at frailty, not disease, not getting ill as a senior citizen, but physiologic deterioration. And what are the factors, both biophysiologic factors and social and environmental factors that contribute to frailty? And how can we alter that so as to increase healthy living over a longer period of time? An example of a program is the Experience Corps that involves seniors working with young children, bringing them into schools and into different settings, and looking not just at the benefits of these cross-generational activities, but what are the benefits to seniors in terms of reducing frailty, increasing mentation, and productivity and healthy living. So these are some of the kinds of things that we're exploring in and with the aging population. The single most protective factor in the lives of young people are social connections. One, social connections with parents. Not so much what parents say, but so much more the relationships, the sense of caring and connectedness. Two, what we've seen is the central role of schools. School as a protective environment, and specifically the role the teachers play in supporting young people. And that relationship, the teacher-student relationship, not in terms of health education or sex education, but in terms of support for one's sense of oneself, support for me as an individual and for me as a student, has a tremendous impact on cigarette smoking, alcohol use, risk of interpersonal violence, pregnancy risk, contraceptive behavior. And so what that really has done is it has led us to do quite an extensive amount of work in school health. Upwards of 60% of high school students are disengaged from school, and those are the ones who are still in school. In many school districts, we know that large numbers of young people drop out. One of the areas where we're doing a lot of work is identifying best practices for engaging young people. How do you, in a non-confrontational way, maintain as a teacher control of a classroom? How do you create a democratic classroom so it really is fully participatory? There are numerous strategies for doing that. How do you engage parents? We have a monograph series that we send to school principals and superintendents across the country on various strategies. We are developing a CD that will be distributed across the country. So people can see and touch and smell how schools that do this well actually do it. From 1991 to the present time, teen pregnancy has declined in this country. It has declined upwards of close to 25%. That in itself is dramatic. The greatest decline among causes of pregnancy is that adolescent males are causing many fewer pregnancies today. And the greatest decline in initiating pregnancies are among African-American males, which is to say the shift in behavior among males is greater than the shift in behavior among females, and it is greatest among African-American males, which is a combination of abstinence to a small extent and contraception to a great extent in the increased use in condoms. I use that as one example. We see this internationally as well. We have a trial right now going on in Rakai, in Uganda, looking at male circumcision. And there is very good evidence to suspect that male circumcision may well be protective, perhaps highly protective, against HIV. And this trial is going to be finalized and released in early 2007. If it is true that the preliminary evidence is borne out in this larger study, then the next question is, well, how do you get adult males to agree to circumcision? Well, one of the things that we're in fact seeing in Rakai is that that's not a problem. In fact, that males are interestingly lining up . Maternal depression is very real. It is biophysiologic in its origins, and its consequences can be profound. We have extreme and very tragic examples of women killing their children in ways that we say, how can this be? But the reality is that you're talking about, in that case, the most extreme forms of depression, which is homicidal and suicidal depression. But we are learning that the scope and range of maternal depression is much greater. So, well, one of the things that we are studying and looking at is, one, what's the magnitude of this issue? Two, how does this impact the dyad, mother and child, and three, what are the kinds of supports that can moderate this? Because it clearly is a significant public health issue. Twenty to 50% of women talk about having had violent sexual experiences, coercive sexual experiences. And there is no question but that sexual violence is not a trivial cause or means of HIV transmission, but it's something that until very recently wasn't even discussed, wasn't even on the radar screen. The relationship between partner violence and women's death is clearly extremely strong in India, in parts of China, where both case reports and studies have come out. The association between spousal abuse and physical abuse in that case and women's suicide is clearly a major relationship that contributes to female suicide. Science is complicated, and it is very hard to do it in 5-second sound bites. So on the one hand, we are training our students and our researchers how to speak to the press and how to take complex information and try to do it very succinctly. But on the other hand, we know that it isn't black and white. It's shades of gray. Science is really gray. It is on the one hand this and on the other hand that. And as a society, we have a very low tolerance for it. And the consequence is we pay a very high price for our low tolerance. And these are issues that we need to talk about. We know that lead is profoundly harmful to kids, and yet lead toxicity persists as a very significant problem and very hard to really get true lead abatement. We know that secondhand passive smoke is very harmful. We know that mortality and morbidity associated with access to firearms is profoundly destructive. And in this city, in Baltimore, it is one of the huge issues that we face. We know a lot about what prenatal care can do to improve the outcomes for neonates. But the gap between that knowledge and the delivery of services is not trivial. In other intellectual ventures, it is sufficient to understand the science. In public health, that's necessary but not sufficient. If you don't take then the science to action, then you're not doing your job. We have collaborative partners in countries throughout sub-Saharan Africa, in Asia, in Latin America, with the goal of building academic capacity over a 10-year period of time so that when we leave there, they have the capacity to train master's and doctoral students and not to need to send them across the globe to do it. So that kind of training in science, in public health methodologies, and in the application of those methodologies for service delivery and for programs is a major priority of how we work. And thus, for us, working in collaboration with sister and brother institutions around the world is a critical way that we go about doing our work.